Hey everyone, it's Jeff Gelman of Solid Canine Training. Let's talk separation anxiety. Listen, we're not seeing separation anxiety here. Now, I get a lot of calls, especially from people that are doing rescue and foster dogs, but also just my regular clients. The dogs are suffering from separation anxiety. Anything from just heavy panting, barking in the crate, trying to get out of the crate, peeing in the crate, to out and out, jumping through second floor windows, busting through screens to get to their owners that are leaving at our board and train facility. After the first 24 hours, if a dog has separation issues, we are not seeing it. Why? Why am I not seeing a dog that spent the last 3 to 4 years with separation anxiety stop it within 24 hours? This is what I want to share with you, and this is really important, and I'll tell you why. Dogs are being turned back into shelters for separation issues. People are killing their dogs for separation anxiety. I know, yell and scream as much as you want, but it is happening. I'm not seeing drugs fix it. Now, I'm not saying drugs don't work, but I'm not seeing drugs alone fix separation issues. What I like to do is get the dogs off the drugs, implement my training and household management system, and then separation anxiety melts away. Now, I've got a perfect example of a dog right here. This dog, Oscar, pants, probably the biggest panter I've ever seen. Is he anxious? Is he nervous? Is he afraid? If you've been following his story, he's been here for 1 week. This is a dog that was out of control, lunging, growling, barking, jumping, racing around the house. So what's he doing now? Awesome obedience, but the energy though, he's still got it. So we're working on getting rid of that energy. So let's talk about some really common sense things. The structured walk, key. A lot of people walk their dogs, but it's a casual walk. I want my dog on my right, I want my dog on my left, I want no sniffing, no marking, no soiling, no lunging, no barking. The walk is a mission. At my side, at my pace. When I stop, the dog stops and sits automatically. Key, not just for separation issues, but general disobedience or obedience. Take your walk serious, you get serious behavior. Take your walk casual, you get casual behavior. Number one, the structured walk. I don't believe in crates. I don't want to contain my dog. Makes it feel like a prison. Oh, he came from a shelter. I don't want to think he's back in a shelter. He was stuck in a crate all his life. Listen, if you have a dog that has separation issues, crate train your dog. Just in general, crate train your dog. I'll tell you why. Your dog is destroying and soiling your house. You say to yourself, well, that was Aunt Sally's sofa. Yeah, but the dog don't know about Aunt Sally. That could have been a $5,000 sofa you just bought. How about this? Your dog eats part of the sofa and dies. It happens. For the safety of your dog and the safety of your personal property, crate train your dog. Your dog should need to learn how to go in and out of the crate on command. I've got a great video I'm going to put up there about how to crate up your dog. So we want to crate your dog up. Let me show you how. On command. Oscar, okay. Kennel. Nope. Kennel. Good. I want my dog to be crated on command. I'm not pulling, prodding, any of that stuff. In your kennel. And then just because the door's open, and if you watch my crate videos, you'll know that that doesn't mean anything. Let's go, Oscar. Place. Nope. Good. So getting your dog to go in and out of the crate, key. Even when you're home. You know what? Put your dog in the crate for a couple of hours. This concept of our dog should always be following us around, big mistake. Oh, makes us feel good. Look, my dog loves me. It's right behind me. Till you are taking the pasta to the sink and you scald your dog and you scald yourself. So it's not cute. It actually increases separation issues. If you want your dog to stop being so anxious, give it space. So crate train your dog. Number three, control the space in your house. I talked about this on number two. My dog doesn't always have to be next to me. If I want to go sit down on my couch, well, the dog doesn't have to run over to me. Jump on my lap, jump over here, have the dog over there. Let the dog be over there. And we're using this dog on purpose because he's anxious. Look at him. He's panting, panting, panting. We're going to work through that though. That's why I'm doing this. You know me from my videos, I'm totally transparent. I could have gotten a perfectly behaved dog over here. I'm not though. I've got a dog here that's struggling with issues that we've had for a week. So, space. You're eating dinner, I want your dogs in place. You're sitting at your computer, I want your dogs in place. Your kids are watching TV, your kids are playing games, I want your dog in place. This teaches dogs on how to be alone, how to exist. If we can't get a dog to exist with us in the room, how are we gonna get our dogs to exist when we're out of the room? Huge thing, control the space, the real estate that your dog has. Very important. Unless the outside of your house says Wally World on it, it's not a theme park. Stop having your dog jump from couch to couch, to barking out the window, to going in to see what's coming out of the laundry machine, to chasing the cat, to always nipping at the kids. This also goes with place. Calm. I want dogs to be calm inside the house. If we can't create calmness when we are home, how are we going to create calmness when we're not home? Remember, this is not a theme park. It's quiet time. That's what I'm looking for. Oscar, I love you. I missed you. Come on, guys. I think no matter how you train your dog, we all can agree on that one. Stop coming home and being all excited to see your dog. Just, I know you missed your dog. I know you love your dog. I know your dog is happy to see you. If you're struggling with a lot of these issues, though, stop it. When you come home, you should be like, please, dog, out of my way. I'm an important person. I got things to do. At least hug and kiss your spouse first, your boyfriend, your girlfriend. At least say hello to your kids. The dog is last. And we should only be saying hello to our dog when it's calm. When we leave the house, I'll be right back. Be a good boy. Be a good girl. Daddy's just running down to the store. You think that freaking dog knows what going down to the store means? All the dog knows is this. You're leaving, and I'm a dog, and I'm going to get all anxious. Stop. When you leave, kennel the dog up, close the door, leave. No big introductions, no big exiting. Just make it happen. It's a dog. So entering and exiting, keep it calm. If you have a dog that's suffering from separation issues, I want you to start cutting down on your verbal and your physical and your food praise. I'm not telling you not to do any of that stuff. Cut it down. Why? It's not working, obviously. I've never seen a dog been able to be physically praised, verbally praised, or food praised out of separation issues. I want that to be cut down. So let's lower all this excitement. Just lower the excitement. Make it more calm. I want you folks to start treating dog training, dog existence, like a lifestyle, not a series of tricks. It's really, really important that we don't just, our dog's freaking out and we're like, come over here and sit. Or our dog is getting up on something and just yelling at it. Everything is holistic, okay? It's the circle of training. Real world dog training is everything. So I want you to start setting up your day, just like we should be setting up our day as lifestyle. Dog training is lifestyle. It's 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, 365 days a year. Do you want to go for a walk? Do you want to eat? Do you want to go for a car ride? Enough! Stop asking your dog if they want to do something. Nah, honey, you just take the car out. Nah, I've already eaten enough. Of course the dog wants to eat, go for a walk, go for a car ride. Let me tell you what you're doing. Do you want to go for a walk? I'm excited, the dog gets all excited, starts jumping around. That's not what we're looking for. You know why we do that? It makes us feel good. Personal, selfish reasons. We get our dog excited and it makes us feel good. That's why as a country we give our dogs so many treats. But we also have an obesity problem in our country with our dogs. Think about this. Calmness. Calmness. I want you to start taking your dogs on the treadmill. I want you to teach your dog how to walk on the treadmill. Treadmill work dramatically helps with both mental and physical exercise. We're finding that a lot of dogs that are anxious, what do with them? We actually can put more structured exercise, more structured exercise. Now listen, a lot of times people say, oh, your dog needs more exercise. Agreed. That doesn't mean going in the backyard and throwing a ball for 30 minutes. All that does is get the dog escalated. I'm looking for a structured exercise. This concept of taking all these toys and stuffing them with food and leaving them with the dog, wouldn't that be great if that could get rid of separation anxiety? The dog doesn't need that. We have we have deer antlers, deer, moose, or elk antlers in our kennels. That's all we have. All we have. Most dogs, what do they do when they go to the kennel in my place? Nothing. They sleep. We don't need to occupy their time in the kennel. All these different games and activities. Listen, do the things that I told you to do. Massive amounts of reduction in separation anxiety. Massive amounts. That's the proactive stuff. A lot of this stuff is common knowledge. No one's doing it, unfortunately, but it's common knowledge. Nobody talks about correcting separation issues. I do. It's important that we give our dogs information. Yes, no. Correct, not correct. Remember that. We talk about that in a lot of my videos. You could actually correct a dog from anxiety. How do you do that? First of all, excessive barking. Let's talk about bark collars. Bark collars are probably the biggest lifesaver out there for dogs. I'll tell you why. So many of my clients, Jeff, I'm in an apartment, I'm gonna get kicked out if I don't shut my dog up for barking. Okay, I don't care if you run that dog 20 hours a day. Guess what? When you leave, that dog's barking. A bark collar, and not the one that sprays stuff. I'll tell you why. This is my philosophy on the spray ones. They're cruel, they're abusive. Let me explain my thinking on that. To us, a little citronella spray, well, that sounds gentle, but for the dog barks. Citronella spray sprays. What's the most sensitive part on a dog? Its nose. So it sprays, it smells it. You think that smell goes away? No, 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 no. That smell stays for a very long period of time, not just for the dog. If we can walk into a room an hour after the spray goes off and we can smell it, what do you think it's doing to the dog? So this dog is sort of like, I was corrected an hour ago, but I'm still being corrected. What am I doing wrong? It's very, very confusing. So I am not a big fan of citronella collars. I would never personally use one or recommend one. Now, the bark collars that give the stim, some people call them shock, but it's a stim, is a split second correction. Bark, oh, geez, that was a little bit uncomfortable. Bark, oh, geez, that was a little bit uncomfortable. Maybe I'm not supposed to be barking anymore. What happens? I use them, I know they work, my clients use them, I know they work. So spray sounds more user-friendly to us as humans. The stim sounds a little bit meaner, but it's actually, the way the dog looks at it, it's the opposite. The spray is actually mean, the stim is sort of like, oh, well, thanks for telling me. We have to give our dogs information. That's what's missing. Now, that's the barking. How can I correct all the nonsense whining though? Believe it or not, you can actually correct the whining. Nobody talks about this. I talk about this. Why? I'm looking to keep your dog in your family. I'm looking to make your life better. And I'm tired of seeing families struggle when all they gotta do is take one or two fingers and knock it off. I'm not hitting my dog. Watch. See this dog is a whining dog. And he was whining, whining, whining. Well, let's put him in the kennel. Come here, Oscar. Kennel up. Good. So say I got a whining dog here. He's whining and whining and whining. I walk over to the kennel. I would walk over to the kennel. I would take one or two fingers and I would just maybe poke him in the chest or poke him right in the sweet spot right there. Now, I'm probably going to give it a hard time about this. I realize that. But I'm not hitting my dog. I'm not kicking my dog. I'm taking one or two fingers and giving a little poke. It's like, knock it off already. How do I know that works? Because we do it on our property and it works. Again, I'm communicating with the dog. I'm giving the dog information. You know what is abusive? Letting a dog stay in a frame of mind, a state of mind that is torturous. That's what's abusive in my book. We have to release the anxiety. And believe it or not, once in a while, a quick little poke, the dog's like, oh, well, why didn't you just tell me that earlier? So it's okay. I'm not telling you to hit the dog. You're not using your open hand. You're not using your feet. We're talking one or two fingers, a poke. You could also use a pet convincer. A great way to correct excessive barking and whining and stress and anxiety is a pet convincer. All this is compressed air. It's a compressed air cartridge. We carry them on our website, but you can get them right on Amazon if you want to. All it does is, it's just air, clean air. How do you use it? This is how I use a pet convincer. I've got a dog right here that's being anxious, a little bit anxious. I would just take it. Go like that. It just knocks the dog out of that state of mind. Remember, we need to unleash this dog's state of mind. The dog will not be open to new information until we break through. We need to break through. Also, remote collars. Everybody knows, and I've talked about it many times, about my very successful remote collar training program. 90% of the time, we use remote collars to highly motivate dogs, to get them to do incredible obedience stuff. But yes, we also use it for correction. On a low level, if your dog was whining, crying, or barking, you can actually just give them a very low stim pressure. Remember, we talk about pressure on, pressure off in a lot of my videos. Just a very low stim to just be like, oh, geez, what the heck was that? We need to break the cycle of stress, of anxiety. We're very successful doing this here. Everything that I suggest in my videos, we incorporate here. I've got a 24/7, 365 model. It works all the time. Separation anxiety. I know you guys are struggling. I feel for you. I want you to know, though, that this concept of run your dog more, play with your dog more, give it all kinds of food, treats, stuffed toys. I'm not seeing that work. I'm not saying it doesn't. I'm not seeing that work. What I'm seeing work is all the things that I described for you. Again, I'm in this with you. I care about you guys. I want you to be successful with your dogs. My name is Jeff Gelman. My company is Solid Canine Training. I do board and train as well as one-on-one at-home training. Remember, hug your kids, train your dogs, and I love you. I really do. Thanks.